am Mr. True. In this video, we're going to be talking about inequalities in one triangle. Basically, for the majority of the video, what that means is we're just going to be looking at the relationship between the size of all of the sides around a triangle and the angles opposite those sides. So we're going to first look at this. Comparison property of inequalities. If A is equal to B plus C, and C, this addition that's being added to B, is greater than 0, then A is greater than B. So basically what that means as far as our triangles go, well, we have the corollary to the exterior angle theorem. The measure of an exterior angle, which remember is just formed by taking the side of a polygon and just extending it off, so I've got this this bottom of my triangle extending off to the left. The measure of an exterior angle of a triangle is greater than the measure of each of its remote interior angles. Remember, again, the exterior angle of a triangle is equal to the sum of the two inside angles, interior angles, that are not adjacent to that exterior angle, or the remote interior angles. So we have from the angle addition, or the exterior angle theorem on triangles, that the measure of angle 1, or exterior angle, is equal to the measure of angle 2 plus the measure of angle 3. Well, keep it in mind that it's not possible to have a negative measurement. You can't weigh a negative number of pounds or stones or kilograms, whatever. You can't have a negative number of meters or feet of an object, like say a tape measure. You have this plastic or metal casing of tape and you pull it out, right? You don't measure it backwards. You pull it out and you take positive measurements of length, area, the size of angles, the number of degrees of an angle. So when you look at the measure of angle 1 equals the measure of angle 2 plus 3, all of these three terms are going to be positive measurements. So, you know, if I take 20 plus 30, I get an answer of 40. The sum is always going to be greater than each of the two individual parts. so, okay, that just means that when you have an exterior angle setting, it's bigger than the two remote interior angles. So how are we going to use that in some diagrams? Well, over here, I kind of have what is a paragraph proof started. So it's not a regular two-column proof with our statements and our reasons, but we have a triangle here, A, B, D, and I've got the three sides marked off as all being equal, which means that triangle ABD is a equilateral triangle. It's also equal angular. They go hand in hand. And then we just would appear to have what appears to be a scalene triangle. And I want to show that the measure of angle 1, this angle here, is greater than the measure of angle 5. Well, there is no direct connection, really, between the size of angle 1 and the size of angle 5. But, let's see here, the measure of angle something is equal to the measure of angle 4 since triangle ABD is equilateral. So this is kind of like given information. This is an equilateral triangle, and what do we know about those? Well, we know that all the sides and thus all the angles are going to be equal. So the measure of angle 1 is equal to the measure of angle 4. Well, now that we know that, now that we know that these two measurements are equal, I'm going to start focusing on this angle 4. And we have, I'm not sure if you can see the green has a big enough difference to the white. Let's try blue. I'm going to start working on that triangle, and we're going to focus on angle 2, which I've kind of now obscured a little bit, angle 5, and angle 4. Okay, so the measure of angle 4 is n. Okay, if you just focus on that blue triangle, I've just simply extended one of the sides. So angle 4 is, again, an exterior angle. Let me pause this for just a second. Okay, the sun was coming in. I was looking like I was getting pretty washed out there on the video. So measure of angle 4 is an exterior angle of triangle DBC, and thus the measure of angle 4 is going to be equal to the measure of the two remote interior angles. It's going to be 2 plus 5, and I'm just going to put angle 2 plus angle 5. We do need to have those measurement angles in there. This means that the measure of angle 4, now the measure of angle 4 is equal to the sum of these other two positive measurements. That means the measure of angle 4 is going to be greater than 2, but we're really worried about angle 5. It means that this angle is going to be also greater than the measure of angle 5. Thus, you know, if we've got 1 equals 4, and angle 4 is greater than angle 5, and well, now I can use basically the substitution property and take out this measure of angle 4 and replace it with its equivalent expression, which is the measure of angle 1. So we can look at triangles, and I never really, with this diagram, found the measure of angle 1 or 2 or 5 for that matter, but still knowing this exterior angle theorem and how a sum is equal to the parts which add up to that sum as long as one or both parts are going to be positive, I can look at this diagram and kind of like, you know, see the order of the size of these angles. And that might be helpful when we start finding the actual measurements of these angles. If I get some measurement that I was expecting to be larger than something else and end up being smaller, then well, that can help me realize that I've made an arithmetic error somewhere. Let's move on to our next page of notes. Inequalities between angles and the sides. If two sides of a triangle are not congruent, then the larger angle lies opposite the larger side. Now, it appears like this side here is longer than the base of this, let's see here, triangle with two sides equal. I think that's called isosceles. Looks like this leg is longer than the base, so the angle that is opposite that longer side is going to be larger than the angle that is opposite the smaller side. Let's look at that relationship here really quick. Well, what do you think happens if the two sides are actually congruent and, you know, not incongruent, if you will? Well, let me see. If these two sides are of equal length, we already know this. This is an isosceles triangle, and the angles that are opposite those sides which are congruent are congruent themselves. So not only is the smaller angle opposite the smaller side and the larger angle opposite the larger side, but if you have two sides which are equal, not exactly what this is saying, then the angles that are opposite those sides which are equal in a triangle, those angles are equal themselves, just like sort of the properties of isosceles triangle that we already learned a couple of chapters ago. Well, we know that the inside of a triangle has to add up to 180 degrees, so if we have 180 degrees and we take out 40, that leaves us with 140 degrees, and these two angles, which need to share that equally, well, we're going to divide that number of degrees equally. So 140 divided by 2 is equal to 70 degrees. So now that we know that this angle is 70 degrees, then we also know that BC is going to be, the length of BC is going to be less than the length of AC, because BC is opposite 40 degrees and AC is opposite 70. 70 is bigger than 40, so AC is bigger than BC. And if those two sides are equal, well, then the angles that are opposite those equal sides are going to be equal themselves, and we call those base angles in an isosceles triangle. The triangle inequality theorem. The sum of the lengths of any two sides of a triangle is greater, of course there's three of these settings, but is greater than the length of the third side. Now what the heck does that mean? That AC plus CB, let's see here, AC plus CB is going to be longer than AB, and so on as you go around the triangle. Well, how does that work? Does that make sense? Well, of course it makes sense. What is the, what is the shortest distance between two points? If I take, let's see here. If I take a cord, it's a little bit tangled up here, so let's, oh, there we go. If I take a cord and I pull it tight, and I want to measure the distance between my two, you know, hands, my two fingers, what's the shortest way to measure the distance between two points? A straight line. So, if I have AB, then point A and point B, then segment AB is going to be the shortest distance to get, you know, between those two points. Well, a triangle is made up of three non-collinear points. So if I go off in a different direction, then that sum has to be larger. That this distance from A out here to C and then back to B has to be longer than the shortest way to get from A to B, which is a straight line. So kind of sort of just makes sense, this triangle inequality theorem. So then you bear the question, you know, well, if I give you these three lengths, can you determine whether or not If I gave you a piece of uncooked spaghetti that was 5 units long, or, you know, like say 5 centimeters long, and another one that was 6 centimeters long, and another one that was 9 centimeters long, could you use those three lengths to make a triangle? Well, this property says basically that any two sides of a triangle must be longer than the third side. So let's see here, 5 and 6 is 11, which is longer than 9. We have 5 and 9, which is 14, which is longer than 6. And we have 6 and 9, which is equal to 15, which is bigger than 5. So these three sides, 5, 6, and 9, are going to make a triangle, because if I take any two sides, the length of those sides, and add them up, I'm going to have a sum which is longer than the third side. But we got a problem here in part B. You know, do the sides of 2, 3, and 7, if I gave you a length, some kind of measurement. In class, we sometimes use uncooked spaghetti because it's stiff and it's easy to manipulate and cheap. 2 centimeters long, 3 centimeters long, 7 centimeters long. Is that going to make a triangle? Well, no, because 2 plus 3 is equal to 5, and that is not going to even, you know, it's not even going to reach that length of 7. In other words, if I have a length of 7, and I take a length of 2 and a length of 3, the fact that 2 plus 3 is only equal to 5, 5's not going to be long enough, that combined length is not going to be long enough to reach from this point to this point, which has a length of 7. So there's your inequality, triangle inequality theorem. Let's take a look at a couple of examples that involve a couple more examples that involve this theorem. Bam! Three examples and we're done. What is the range of values for the missing side? So if I give you the side of 5, if I give you a length of 8 or a side of 8, what can the third side be and still be able to get a triangle? Still have the situation where, you know, if you add any two sides up, it's going to be longer than the third side. I'm really, really visual. So what I've done here is I've got a length that, you know, I've kind of estimated to be a length of 8, a length, you know, that's proportional, it's shorter, so it's going to be our length of 5. And kind of show you that, you know, these two sides are going to become, obviously going to meet, the 5 and 8, and there's this pivot point here that, you know, between these endpoints you're going to add a third side in and make that triangle. And how long is this third side going to be I'm not sure if it's going to show up in the camera very well, but so let's see, I can take this 5 and 8, now I can take this length of 5 and rotate it out and kind of stretch out the two sides. Well, that means I'm going to add the lengths of 5 and 8 to sort of find out how long is this if you just stretch it tight. Now, it can't be exactly equal to that length, but I can just bend it a little bit and shorten it up. 5 plus 8 is going to be equal to, let's see here, 13. So, now x cannot be this third side here. That third side cannot be an exact measurement of 13, because then I would just have a segment, a straight segment, not a triangle. But if it's just a little bit less than 13, then those two sides are going to have to kind of bend a little bit to get that reduced length of 13, and that will start to form our triangle. Or I can swing this 5 in and subtract these two lengths, and because if I swing this in, this side is going to get shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter until, 8 minus 5 is equal to 3. Now, again, this can't be exactly a length of 3, because then we would just be lining up on a straight line and have a segment, not a triangle. But if x is even just a little bit bigger than 3, or if x is between 3 and 13, then we can have 5, 8, and any value between 3 and 13 that will make a triangle. So when you're given two sides, two lengths, and you're asked, hey, what's the third side have to be so we can make a triangle? You basically just add these numbers up, subtract these numbers, and that is the range of values that the third side can take on. Woo! Next example, I kind of already did this in the previous page, but this is a scalene triangle where all of my angles are different in size, and thus all of my sides are going to be different in length, and thus this is a scalene triangle. It's also a right scalene triangle. So what lists the order of the sides from the least to the greatest? Well, if I want the smallest length of the triangle, I'm going to go find the smallest angle, and the side opposite is going to be the smallest length, so BC is going to be less than, well, that's 90, right? So this is 65. That's a little bit bigger than 25, but not as much as 90. So the next largest angle is B, so the next largest side is opposite of that, and that's AC. And then finally, the hypotenuse of this right triangle, the hypotenuse is always the longest side of a right triangle because it is always opposite the biggest angle, which is 90 degrees. And that's going to be AB. Over here, we've got this these triangles that are, you know, pressed together, and thus we have sort of like kind of like a quadrilateral with a diagonal drawn through it, or two triangles that are sort of basically adjacent, sharing a side. And we want to find out which of these three sides, or excuse me, which of these five lengths is going to be the shortest length. We're not going to have enough information to find the length, just which one is going to be shortest. Well, let's find the missing angle up here, angle B. Well, inside of a triangle, they have to add up to 180 degrees. So angle B, the measure of angle B, is going to be equal to 180 minus 117 minus 29. Let's see if we can do this in our head. Might be a little bit of a, might see me pause and think a little bit, but we got 180 minus 100 is 80, minus 10 is 70, minus, I'm going to skip that 7 for a little bit, minus 20, let's see here, let's back up, 180, 100, 70, 70 minus 20 is 50, 50 minus 7 is 43, and 43 minus 9, 43 minus 9 is 34 degrees. Let me just double check that, and we're good. So this angle, measure of angle B, is 34 degrees. Oh, you might have noticed that when I did that mental subtraction in my head, I went from left to right, so I didn't have to carry, you know, borrow and carry, which is a little bit harder to do in your head. So anyway, that's 34 degrees. Now, so that means that for this triangle on the right, we got 117, we have 29, and we have 34 degrees. Well, on this triangle on the right, 29 is the smallest angle, so at least for the triangle on the right, BC is the smallest length. Well, is BC the smallest? Well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I know for at least this triangle over here, it is the smallest. And so I've kind of already thought about and worked with this triangle. I'm just going to forget about it. And I'm going to use the other triangle in the diagram to verify or check, you know, really was BC, or in that entire diagram, which now we don't see anymore, is BC the longest, or excuse me, the smallest side? Well, over here, oh, I've got a missing angle in this triangle. So in here, the measure of angle A is 180 minus 110 minus 33, so 180 minus 100 is 80, minus 10 is 70, 70 minus 30 is 40, and 40 minus an additional 3 that 1's place, 40 minus 3 is 37 degrees. So in this triangle, 37 degrees. Now, we were trying to make sure that BC, which I see I erased the B, we were trying to verify that for the entire diagram was BC the smallest side. Well, now that I look at the rest of the diagram, 33 degrees is less than 37, so even though BC was the smallest side, well, as far as this triangle is concerned, and which was part of the overall big big diagram, 33 is less than 37, so that means that AB is opposite yet a smaller angle for this particular triangle. You do want to kind of look at these one at a time and work your way through the diagram. 33 is less than 37, that means that AB is less than BC. So no, for the entire diagram, BC was not the smallest side. Actually, AB is. And that is the end of my example and the end of this video. So, Mr. True, go do your homework.